What about breakfast?
We've already had it.
We've had one, yes. What about second breakfast? What about elevensies? Luncheon, afternoon tea, dinner, supper.
Limbus, one small bite is enough to fill the stomach of a grown man.
The salted pork is particularly good.
Hobbits.
Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to Binging with Babish, where this week we are celebrating 7 million subscribers with a two-part episode exploring the seven Hobbit meals from Lord of the... What's this? It's a ring. Ha ha, very funny. Somebody has After Effects. Come on back, Andy. Andy, come back. The Nazgul, they're coming. Whew, okay. Better leave this here so I am not seduced by its overwhelming power. But... the precious. We needs it. Okay, enough horsing around. We're starting with the dish that requires the most lead time, that being salted pork. First, we need to make a cure of about 5 parts kosher salt, 1 part sugar, along with a couple handfuls of peppercorns or juniper berries. Then onto the pork that is being salted, I'm going with some pork belly. You could really salt almost any cut of pork, but I'm going with belly, which I'm going to remove the skin from and cut into manageable pieces. Then into a food-safe container like a Cambro, we're going to start layering salt and pork, making sure that every square inch of pork is covered by and packed into the salt mixture. Now, what we're essentially making here is unsmoked bacon, and when refrigerated, could last theoretically up to a year. For more information, go check out the Townsend's channel. But for more immediate consumption, we want to give it at least 4 days, brushing off the salt and covering with cold water to desalinate in the fridge overnight, before preparing as desired. Next up, we have to tackle the tricky question of lembas bread, or since I am not elven born, technically we're making cram, the closest real-world equivalent of which I think is hardtack, a simply prepared cracker with an extraordinarily long shelf life. Basically, we're just mixing together 840 grams of all-purpose flour, 240 ml of water, and 1 teaspoon of kosher salt, kneading gently until it becomes smooth and cohesive, and then rolling out to our desired thickness. Since we're trying to go for the lembas bread aesthetic, I'm gonna roll it out nice and thin, dusting with additional flour as necessary, and then trimming off the edges so that I might cut this thing into squares. Then we're going to place shallow cuts in these squares in an X-shaped pattern. This is going to make for easy portioning on the long journey ahead, and make sure you roll out your scraps too, don't be wasteful. Once everybody is cut out and scored up, we're going to place them on a parchment-lined baking sheet, giving them a 2 to 3 hour long stint in a very low oven, as low as you can get your oven to go. The objective here is to dry out the bread completely. The less moisture that's in it, the longer a shelf life it will have. Now, I know this might be a disappointing realization of lembas bread in the real world, but I don't do magic foods. Sorry, that is Babish store policy. Next up, we're making something that I'm particularly excited about, honey cakes. Tolkien describes honey cakes as a hearty, twice-baked cake good for travel. To me, that means a sort of honey biscotti. So into the bowl of a stand mixer, we are combining 120 grams of unsalted room temperature butter, 2 large eggs, and 175 ml of honey. In this recipe adapted from Serious Eats, we're gonna cream these on medium speed for about 3 minutes until nice and smooth, pausing only to add a teaspoon and a half of vanilla extract and the zest of 1 whole lemon. Go ahead and cream those together for an additional minute, and then it's time to begin negotiating our dry ingredients. 500 grams of all-purpose flour, 1/2 teaspoon of baking powder, 1/4 teaspoon of baking soda, and 1/2 teaspoon of kosher salt. Tiny whisk to combine, and dump directly into the wet stuff. Go ahead and mix this on medium-low speed for 1 to 2 minutes until it forms a cohesive dough. A dough which we are going to shape into some logs. Normally with biscotti, you'd want to go with very wide, flat logs, but we're going to go with tall, round logs, so that the resulting cookies better resemble cakes. Once you've got the dough formed into 2 evenly sized, I can't think of another word for logs, go ahead and plop those on a parchment-lined baking sheet, brush down with a beaten egg, and sprinkle with turbinado sugar. Then these guys are headed into a 350 degree Fahrenheit oven for about 20 minutes until lightly blonde and beginning to crack. As soon as you can handle handling them, pop them off the baking sheet and place them onto a cutting surface so that you can use your very sharpest knife to cut them into cookies or cakes. And remember, since these were described in the books as twice baked, so too shall we. Return our cakes or cookies or whatever they are back onto the parchment-lined baking sheet and continue to bake, this time at 300 degrees Fahrenheit, for an additional 20 minutes until lightly toasted and firm, flipping once halfway through baking to ensure even browning. Be careful while baking because they're going to be a little crumbly and a little delicate, but once we allow them to cool completely on a wire rack, they're going to solidify considerably. But these cakes only offer a tentative taste of the titular ingredient, honey. To really take the honey flavor to the next level, we need to make a honey glaze. So into a large bowl goes about 200 grams of powdered sugar, 45 grams of honey, and little splashes of skim milk until you reach the desired consistency. We're looking for a relatively thick glaze here because it takes a while to set and we don't want it to run off entirely. Then all there is left to do is generously dress our honey cakes, each with a decisive dollop of our delicious, drizzle. I'm even going to double up to make sure that everybody is well coated, and then optionally you can garnish with a few slivered almonds. And there you have it, some sweet, tender, crumbly, twice-baked honey cakes, which we'll keep in an airtight container at room temperature for 3 to 5 days. Next up, the all-important mince pie, the first step of which is to make some mince. I didn't want to screw this one up, so this recipe is adapted from the one and only Mary Berry. Into a bowl, I'm combining about 700 grams worth of my favorite dried fruit and one small baking apple, peeled, cored, and finely chopped. These guys are then headed into a large saute pan with a melted stick of butter, where they shall stew along with 200 grams of muscovado sugar, the zest and juice of one lemon, and some all-star apple pie spices. You can vary them up however you like, but I went with about a half teaspoon of ground cinnamon, an eighth to a quarter teaspoon of ground clove, a half teaspoon of ground ginger, and a half teaspoon of freshly grated nutmeg. Then we're also going to add about 200 grams of the nuts of your choice. I went with some more flaked almonds, but you could use walnuts or pecans. And then this guy is getting simmered together for about 10 minutes. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is what the British refer to as mincemeat. I don't understand it either, but apparently it has something to do with history. Once the fruit has softened and the liquid has thickened, we're going to kill the heat and allow it to cool completely before adding a splash of some booze. Sherry, brandy, or cognac would be most welcome here. Mix to combine, and then this guy is ready for long-haul storage. It apparently lasts at room temperature in an airtight container for up to 6 months, so it makes sense that a hobbit would have some in his larder. But we are not waiting that long, we're using it right now. To make mincemeat pies, we need a pie dough, and there are a few better ways to make pie dough than with a food processor. So into the bowl of our food processor goes 350 grams of all-purpose flour, 2 tablespoons, or about 25 grams of sugar, and a pinch of kosher salt. Pulse until thoroughly combined, and then we're going to dot the surface with cubes of cold butter, 225 grams to be precise. Pulse that together until the mixture resembles coarse breadcrumbs, and then we're dumping it out into a large bowl and topping it with about 80 milliliters of ice cold water. Gently toss those together with your fingers and a wooden spoon until it starts to clump together, at which point we're going to turn it out onto an unfloured work surface and gently knead it until a cohesive ball of dough forms, which we're going to pat into a disc wrap and plastic wrap and refrigerate for at least 30 minutes, ideally around 2 hours, so it's super firm. Go ahead and pound it out with your rolling pin until it's a slightly larger disc, and then roll it out into an even larger disc until it's about 6 millimeters thick. Then we are using a fluted pastry cutter to cut little rounds that we are then going to deposit into the cavities of a muffin tin. I'm also going to cut out little flower shapes to decorate the tops, and then everybody's headed into the fridge for another 30 minutes before baking. And you'll notice that mine are a little small, and that's because I wanted these to come out hobbit-sized. So into each of our mini pastry cups, we're depositing about a tablespoon worth of our mincemeat, patting it flat, optionally topping with our decorative flour, brushing with egg yolk, and sprinkling with turbinado sugar. And then this guy's headed into a preheated 400 degree Fahrenheit oven for about 15 minutes before we pop them out of the cavities and allow them to cool completely on a wire rack. And yeah, they're a little messy, but aren't they cute? They're hobbit-sized mincemeat pies. Next up in the make-ahead dishes is Bilbo's favorite, seed cake. Into a small bowl goes 170 grams of all-purpose flour, 3/4 of a teaspoon of baking powder, 1/2 teaspoon of kosher salt, and 2 tablespoons of caraway seeds, because we're effectively making a caraway seed cake. I'm also going to add 50 grams of ground almonds for some flavor and texture, and tiny whisk until homogeneous. Then into the bowl of a stand mixer goes 170 grams of unsalted room temperature butter, and 170 grams of granulated sugar, which we're going to beat together until light and fluffy. About 2 to 3 minutes in this recipe adapted from BBC Good Food. We're then going to scrape down the sides of the bowl and beat in 2 large eggs and 1 1/2 teaspoons of vanilla extract. This is going to make your liquid mixture look kind of curdly, but don't let it freak you out. It's going to be fine. Once that is beaten to a state of relative smoothness, we're going to add our dry ingredients and mix on low speed until a thick batter forms. Generously butter and parchment paper your very favorite loaf pan, dump in your cake batter, smooth it out, and top it up with some extra caraway seeds and, for like the 70th time today, some flaked almonds. Then this guy is ready for a 375 degree Fahrenheit oven for 50 to 60 minutes until it emerges lightly cracked golden brown and a toothpick inserted into its thickest point emerges relatively clean. Let it cool off in the pan for 10 minutes before removing it onto a wire rack and allowing it to cool completely. Last but not least in the Megahead saga is a beautiful apple tart from America's Test Kitchen. Into a large bowl goes 180 grams of all-purpose flour, 65 grams of sugar, and a 1/2 teaspoon kosher salt, tiny whisk to combine, and add 280 grams of melted unsalted butter. Mix with a rubber spatula and eventually your fingies until a crumbly dough forms, which, one piece at a time, we're going to pat out into a 20 centimeter tart pan. Is it bothering anybody else that I'm using metric for measurements but not temperatures? I bet it is. Anyway, once our sweet pastry dough has been pressed into every crack and crevice, and the top edges trimmed off to make it nice and neat, we're then going to dock our pastry using a fork. Basically, just poke the surface down with lots and lots of little holes to prevent the pastry from rising in the oven. Into a 350 degree Fahrenheit or 170 degrees Celsius oven it goes for about 30 minutes until nicely golden brown. Set that aside to cool whilst we deal with our apples. I've got 5 large Honeycrisps here that I'm peeling, coring, and quartering, then cutting those quarters in half and each of those halves into another half to make 4 evenly sized slices. Rinse and repeat with the remaining apples until you got yourself a bowl full of identical slices. This consistency is going to help make your tart look real pretty later on. For now, we've got to give them a little cooking. So into a large saute pan with 1 tablespoon of melted butter they go, where we're going to slowly cook them, keeping them covered over medium-low heat and stirring occasionally until they are flexible and translucent. At this point, we're going to pull them off the heat, dump them out onto a rimmed baking sheet, and allow them to cool completely. Whew, thank goodness we don't have to deal with any more nuts. 5 more large Honeycrisps that we're going to likewise peel, core, and quarter, cutting those quarters into slices and then chopping those slices into 1-inch pieces. Because we're trying to cook these apples down into a mush, into 2 tablespoons of melted butter they go, and to magnify their apple flavor, we're going to add about 1/2 cup of apricot preserves. I know that doesn't make sense on paper, but just trust me, this is really, really good. We're cooking that over medium heat for about 10 minutes until the apples are soft and mashable. Then we're going to do just that, mash the apples into a mash, cooking for an additional 5 minutes until nice and thick, and then dumping directly into our prepared tart shell, smoothing that out so the surface is nice and even, and then beginning to decorate with our apple slices. Starting from the outside with the wider side facing up, we are layering the apples on top of each other, working our way towards the middle until they resemble an enchanting apple flower, which we're going to bake in the oven at 350F or 170C for about 20 minutes until the apples are completely soft. In the meantime, we're going to make a glaze for our apples by heating a couple tablespoons of apricot preserves until they're nice and runny and straining out the solids. Once our apple tart emerges triumphant from the oven, we're going to give it a good brush down with this apricot syrup. Once thoroughly coated and glossy, this guy's headed back into the oven one more time, but this time under a preheated broiler, or as the Brits call it, a grill, for about 5 minutes, rotating frequently until it's the most beautiful thing you've ever seen. Allow that to cool completely, and that's it for the Make-Ahead stuff, folks. But next week, we'll be delving into the rest of the dishes to make up this Lord of the Rings feast. My goal was to make one giant spread of foods specifically mentioned in the movies or books that has representatives from each of the 7 Hobbit meals. It's the biggest episode of Binging with Babish ever, and it is my way of saying thank you for helping me reach 7 million subscribers. Thank you guys so much, and I will see you next week.